you guys know, do you know where I'm calling from?
No.
Russia?
Russia?
Russia? I'm not in Russia. I mean, what's the country straight north?
Michigan.
The country?
Canada.
Thank you. We don't go to Michigan much.
It's okay. Michigan's sometimes like a separate country, right?
Yeah.
How's school going today?
Good.
So I was was on the phone yesterday with Emily.
She just came online right before you called. You know, it'll show like who's online. I was like, look, Emily's online. That's funny.
I just talked to her yesterday, and we were talking about you guys actually too.
Uh oh.
Oh, special.
Wait, is that a bad thing?
Is that a bad
thing? She had all good things to say.
She said all good things, guys. Yes. That's good.
We're special.
Okay.
So, what do you guys want to do?
We have a little agenda here. Is that okay with you? You know how teachers are.
Absolutely, I like it.
Okay, and since I'm the teacher, I get to ask the first question, right?
All
right. Okay, what inspired you to start Classroom Champions, and what's the most rewarding part?
What inspired me to start Classroom Champions, and what's the most rewarding part?
That's it.
Those are good questions. So, what inspired me was, how old are you guys?
10.
9 and 10.
Okay. Perfect. So, who here has a brother or a sister?
A bunch of
you guys. Close to everybody. So, my sister and I started Classroom Champions. And my sister's name is Lee. And Lee and I started it because I was just about to be finished being an athlete. And as you guys might know, like, I'm done being an athlete now. And we were going into like my last year. And what we thought was, how cool is it that I'm an Olympian and I'll have all my friends be Olympians and all my friends be these Olympic medalists. So my sister and I talked and we said, let's do something cool with it. And I asked you guys how old you are because I kind of knew you'd be right around 9 or 10. And the way we look at it is, would we think it was cool when we were 10 years old? And that's why we started the program. Because we thought when we were 10 years old, and that's literally the age we use, and we use that with all of our volunteers and all the people that help Classroom Champions. We say, everything we do, we say, we think it was cool when we were 10. And that's why we started Classroom Champions, because we thought, how cool would it have been to get to talk to Olympians all the time and have them communicate with us and learn from them, and how neat would that have been? Because when we were young, you couldn't really do this. You couldn't do this at all. So this wasn't even possible when I was 10 years old. So that's how we started it. And what was the second part to it?
What's the most rewarding part?
Most rewarding part, seeing your guys' videos.
Yay!
That's my favorite part.
They cheered for themselves.
That's my favorite part. My favorite part is, it's very cool for me that Emily is a good friend of mine. She's an old friend of mine. Actually, what I can do is show you guys another friend of ours, a guy named, his name is Joey Cheek. Joey Cheek's an Olympic medalist from the 2006 Olympics, and Joey does some amazing things.
What sport?
In his life. And yeah, if you guys can, you should look up Joey Cheek when we get off Skype here.
Okay.
And what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to share my screen, because Joey posted to Twitter yesterday, a picture of us from 2006. So how old were you guys in 2006?
I was three.
6 years ago. About three. He's gonna share part of his screen there, so it should be coming up. It's loading. Oh my gosh! I see Emily right away. You see her right here. You guys.
Yeah.
Where is?
Do you see me?
Yeah.
Which one is it?
He's right there.
Right under Emily.
Yeah.
She must like your hair. She has a thing about hair, so.
I used to have long hair.
Not mine.
You know, can you see my mouth right now?
You don't.
Yeah, yes?
Yeah. So there's Joey Cheek.
Look, he's pointing to you. Look.
Yeah, so there's Joey Cheek. There's the guy that posted it. There's Emily.
Yep.
This girl here is a good friend of mine. Her name is Shannon Barkey, and Shannon's a two-time Olympic medalist. She's a skier, a mogul skier. She won a silver medal in 2002 and a bronze medal in 2010. In fact, Shannon and I and two other friends of ours took rides in F-16. Do you guys know what an F-16 is?
No.
Fighter, you know what a fighter jets are?
Jet?
Yeah.
Fighter jets, yeah. We got to take rides in a fighter jet. And Shannon, this girl right here, set it all up.
What? Wow.
This woman right here, Vanetta. Vanetta was the first African-American woman to ever win a gold medal in the Winter Olympic Games.
What sport?
In bobsled. She was a bobsled.
Bobsled.
So that's pretty cool, too. And this woman over here is Julie Chu, and Julie is a hockey player who's got a few Olympic medals as well. So
that's awesome.
It's an old picture that's very cool and very special to me. So I thought I would share that.
Very nice.
All right, so who has questions that's sitting on the floor?
That's right. Who has? It's question number one. Who is it?
Oh, Brody.
Okay, nice and loud, Brody.
Did you get along with your sister growing up?
Say that again?
Did you get along with your sister growing up?
Here, wait. Okay, try one more time.
Did you get along with your sister growing up?
Did you get along with my sister growing up?
Yep. It's funny you should say you started this with her, because that was one of our questions.
I started it with her. It's a good question. So she is one of my best friends now. And when we were kids, when we were your age, we didn't get along all that well. And, you know, we had a cottage together, and I can always remember going to the cottage and sitting in the back seat, and we had a line in the back, an imaginary line in the back seat.
Did you do that?
Couldn't cross the line. And now we look back at it and laugh.
Yeah.
So what I always tell people, I'm like, look, no matter how well or not well you do or do not get along with your brother or sister, they will be your really good friend when you're older, so don't do anything too bad to them. I say, don't do anything so bad that when you're older, they're going to come back and they're going to remember it. So just, you know, keep that in mind. They will be your friend, I promise you. No matter how much you don't think so right now, they will be your good friend when you grow up.
Good. Good. Okay, thanks. Who's question two? Okay, Kayla, here you go. Ready?
Where do you keep your gold medals, and how many medals do you have all together?
Where do I keep my gold medals? So my Olympic gold medal stays in my, it sits in one of my drawers in my room, but I actually brought it.
Oh, wait, I gotta get a picture.
Is it real gold?
Yeah. Yep, so it's covered in real gold, yep.
Oh,
would
my
you ever
God.
Sell it?
See it? Can you
no.
see
what
yes.
it? You see what's on the corner? Look what he points
yeah.
you down there.
Yeah.
The
Olympic.
Gold rings. How, is it heavy?
And then on the back here, it's got the little symbol that was the logo for the Vancouver Olympics, which is this thing is called an Inukshuk.
Oh.
Inukshuk, yeah. So it's an old, Canadian Aboriginal symbol, and it means they would place them along paths, along like pathways, so they didn't get lost, and it means have a safe journey. So I thought that was pretty cool. And my other gold medals and my other medals from the World Cup, I have 39 World Cup medals from the World Cup races. You know how Emily every week is going to World Cup competitions all over the world? So
yes.
I did the same thing for 10 years, and over that time, I wound up winning 39 World Cup medals, I won two World Championship medals, and one gold medal. Well, thank you.
That's awesome. Yeah, we're saving something for the end. Okay, who's question after, who's question three? Okay, Haley. Shy little Haley, let's go.
What do you do when you feel like giving up or your goal seems too far away?
What do I do when I feel like giving up or the goal seems too far away? It's a good question. I can remember times, because the Olympics are every 4 years, right? But we had these World Cups every year. So what I would do if my, because they, I mean, 4 years is a long time, right?
Yeah. Like a really long time.
Yeah.
I mean, my first Olympics was before you guys were born, and I was looking at 4 years, every 4 years. And I can remember sometimes, like, being in the gym, and after a certain amount of time in the sport, like, the Olympics were the things that really mattered. The World Cups were almost like training, and I would think, like, the Olympics are 3 years away. Oh, my body hurts right now, like, my back hurts, and things like that, because I was training so hard. So I would always try to find little things that would help me accomplish the goal. So if my goal was 4 years away, it was just such a big goal that was so far away. I mean, to win an Olympic gold medal was such a huge goal, right? So you had to do these things and had to look at every day, find something. So what was cool is being an athlete, and I try to do it now that I'm not, in different ways. But as an athlete, you'd wake up, and when the alarm would go off, who here wakes up with an alarm? here hits the snooze button on your alarm. Or if you get woken up by your mom or your dad, you kind of hit the snooze by saying, go away. Sometimes too. So as an athlete, I never hit the snooze because I always woke up in the morning knowing that I set my alarm for that specific time because that was the best time for me to wake up for training or for class or for anything else. So that was the ways that I kind of like overcame the goal being so far away is I had these little things in me that I would set these tiny little goals every day. And sometimes the goal was simply to wake up when my alarm went off and get out of bed on time because that was what set everything else in motion.
Kaylee wants to know what time that was.
It changed all the time. It was always 2.5 hours before training started.
2.5 hours before training started.
Yeah, so if training was at 9, I would wake up at 6:30. If training was at 10, I would wake up at 7:30. So.
There you go.
Wow.
All right, who's next?
Okay, who's after Haley? Who's after Haley? All right, Brevin.
What would have you done if your athlete career hadn't worked out?
Take that.
What would I have done if my athletic career wouldn't work out? You mean like, so what else would I have done like for a living?
Yeah, like what else did you like to do that maybe could have turned
into? So I went to school, I went to college to be a teacher, to either be a teacher. I did a lot of stuff in like exercise science, so like sport world, so either physical education or health or things like that. So I may have been a teacher. Both of Lee and I's parents, mine and Lee's parents were teachers. So I may have been a teacher. I was a Lego kid. So I really liked to build things when I was a kid. So, I mean, in fact, I would just, lock myself in my room for hours at a time and build things. So I think Costume Champions for me personally is kind of like a Lego set. Like, it's how do I build it and how do we make it better and how do we, it's one of those Lego things that you can always build. You know, if you had enough pieces, you could build it forever. That's kind of what I think. So I would either be a teacher or I would be something where I got to build things.
Nice.
Either an engineer or a business to be able to build businesses.
Okay, nice. Who's after Brevin? Okay, Lizzie. That's all the farther it goes, sister. Okay.
What inspires you and what scares you?
Oh.
What inspires me and what scares me? So what inspires me is thinking about how Classroom Champions is going to grow and connect kids all over the world using sports and using the app, using the Olympians and Paralympians. So that inspires me. I think that's really like what's possible now, and the fact that we're on Skype right now and Skype supports us. I'm not sure if you guys knew that, but Skype is, Skype believes in Classroom Champions. I think that's pretty neat, and that inspires me. What scares me? I think what scares me is living my life not doing the things that I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
What I mean by that is living my life doing things that I feel like I have to do, whether it's because I just have gotten myself down that path. And when the older you get, and you guys know this from kids too, when you start doing something and it starts going one direction, you kind of feel obligated to keep on doing it. So what scares me is starting to do things that don't excite me and feeling obligated. So I would like to find those points in my life where I can fulfill my obligations and complete the tasks that I said I would and set out to do, but then quickly shift into the things that I want to do. So that's what scares me, is not being able to do the things I love.
That's good.
So I'm pretty excited that for right now I get to kind of do everything that I want.
That's good. Okay, who was after her? Carter. Emily Cook's coming on.
Yeah.
Is she joining us?
Yeah.
Look.
Talk about some crashes I had. But first.
Look,
I
Emily.
Hi.
Hey. How are you?
Yeah.
This is a surprise.
You guys have any? So Emily hopped on. I called Emily and I said, "So I'm hopping on with Ms. Regan's class in Indiana. Do you want to say hi?" And there she is.
And where are you? Emily?
I'm back in Park City. I just flew in from Norway the night before last. So
trying to get back on this time zone and get back into training. How are you guys doing?
Good!
Should we give her all a double thumbs up for how she did? We're so proud of you for doing so well! Round of applause for her!
So we just have her for a few. We just have her for a few minutes. Does anybody, while we have Emma on here, does anybody want to ask a quick couple questions for Emily? I know it's catching all dark.
I know. Jay, do you have something?
Well, yeah.
They had all these questions prepared for me, and they didn't really.
We're done.
Thank you. Well, I'm so excited to talk to you guys. Thanks so much for having me.
Go ahead. Ask her. She's right there. Ask her. Go ahead. She won't care. Ask her. She likes to know what kids want to know. She's all right. She got, oh, can you ask her to explain what she just won? Where were you and what exactly did you win? You want to?
Where were you and what exactly did you win?
She wants to know if you got a gold medal. But so we're a little confused on how that works.
I'll tell you all about it. So throughout the season, we travel to a number of different World Cup competitions. So every week, we have a competition with the best athletes in the world, and we call it a World Cup. So I was just in Bukovo, Ukraine, which, have you guys had a chance to look at that on the map?
No, we got to look at it. We will when we hang up.
Okay, good. So I was in Bukovo, Ukraine, which is kind of near Russia, and I won a World Cup there. But the really exciting part about it is that over the season, we add up all of our points, and at the end of the year, the people who were the most consistent get to be on the podium for the whole season. So that win in the Ukraine bumped me up on that ranking. So going into next year, since our World Cup season's over, I'm ranked second in the world now, which is so exciting.
That's awesome. Good for you. Can we go ahead and give them both a standing ovation? Okay, we have to do something, and we'll tell you what it is. Okay, you ready, everybody?
Okay.
Stand up. Let's go. Wonder. And in this book, the little guy that learns something, it's a kind of a long story, but it's the best thing about friendship. You'll see it in our video because it's in all our essays, but he says everybody in their life at least once deserves a standing ovation. And I know you've had a gold medal and everybody's had one, but they're so into it. Our computer tech came in and he fixed something and they all stood up and they applauded and he like beamed because they get it though. Like, appreciate people. So while you're on there together, Steve, you're going to get that at the end, but that's going to count for both of you. Your standing ovations for today. Good for you.
Awesome. Well, I just want to say to you that I really appreciate you guys because having support from you guys back at home is so important, and it makes it so much easier for me to work hard and to reach my goals as well. So thanks, you guys. You guys deserve a standing ovation, too.
Oh, look, they're standing up for us. So sweet. See, makes your whole day. How many people are happy about that? Look, you have gold athletes here that are now standing for you. That's really great. Thank you so much.
All right, guys, so let's have one more question for Em, and then we'll let her go because she just got back from her ride.
Anybody have a question for Emily? I asked her if she's tired, how long the plane ride was. You have any questions? Dalton, what do you got?
How does it feel that you know that you know that you won?
Well, that's a great question. Well, it feels really good, but I also know that there's still a lot of work to be done. So, you know, when you reach one of your goals, to me it's really important to make sure that you remember that there's still more goals, right? So I'm really excited about the way that I performed last week, but I also know that now that I'm home, that there's a lot more work to be done going into the future. So it gives me a little extra motivation going into this next series of training, and it feels very good knowing that all the work that I did do paid off.
And when's the next Olympics for you then? We were talking to Steve about like it's 4 years away. Oh my gosh, I've got so long. How long for you?
You think you have so long, and then all of a sudden you're a year out. So right now, it'll be next February, so I have less than a year until the Olympics.
Oh my gosh, that's great. Yeah. Good for you. Well, happy training, and thank you so much for stopping by.
Thanks, you guys.
Thumbs up.
I need to ask her something.
We'll email her.
Thank you.
Yeah,
bye,
Emily.
Bye.
Well, that was fun.
How cool was that?
That was cool.
That was awesome.
That was cool.
I like the picture.
picture of her.
Good
like
heavens.
Snake attack. Attack.
Oh, that's great. Okay, so the last section. Well,
we have some questions for me.
Brian, you have something you want to read? We have Carter, sorry. Carter has to re-ask his. He didn't get to ask. Is that okay?
Okay.
All right, yeah. Carter.
Talk about some crashes you've had.
Talk about some crashes I've had. Ooh, bobsled crashes, huh? Bobsled crashes are scary. Let's see. I've been in a handful. One that I remember, the first bobsled crash I was ever in when I was a push athlete. So I was a push athlete for most of my career. I won my Olympic medal and my World Cup medals as a push athlete. I did do some driving, but as a push athlete, my first crash as a push athlete was in Altenburg, Germany, which is in old East Germany. It's right along the Czech Republic border, south of, there's a big city called Berlin, and it's Berlin, and then there's like an hour and a half south is Dresden, and then an hour south of there is Altenburg, tiny little town. And one of the scariest and hardest tracks on the bobsled circuit in the world. And I remember it was a training run. I was in the back of the four-man sled. I was riding brakes, which is where Kurt Tomasevich rides now and rode on my team. But I was on the back of the sled. It was fall. It was like November of 2002, quite a long time ago. And we were heading down the track, and we were with Todd Hayes, was my driver at the time. He's an Olympic silver medalist driver. And we came through, and we're coming at curve 9, and the sled goes down this long straightaway, and it goes into a Kreisel turn. And in German, Kreisel means circle. So the sled came into Kreisel, and it comes into Kreisel, and then we went around in this big circle. And as we came out, the sled has all these different pressures that happen. The sled started to go up and down just a little bit more than Todd wanted it to. And he couldn't quite get a hold of it and correct it in time. So we kind of came down a little bit too low, and then we came up a little bit too high in the exit. And all of a sudden, the bobsled's really loud. If you watch video of bobsled, it's just like this, so loud. And all of a sudden, it's really, really loud, and all of a sudden, it goes quiet. And what quiet meant was that your runners, the blades, weren't on the ice anymore. They weren't chattering on the ice anymore. And all of a sudden, it goes quiet, and then you feel your head slam into the ice. And then all of a sudden, it's super loud. It's louder than anything you've ever heard. And the sled is on its upside down, going about 80 miles an hour. So if you think about it, in a car, your parents probably drive on the highway. They probably drive around 60 or 70 miles an hour. So we're going 80 miles an hour on top of our heads. The sled's on top of us. And I can remember coming through. That was out of curve 10, curve 11, 12, 13. And it was really scary. And I decided that I was in a bad position. I couldn't really hold on anymore. And I was kind of getting beat up. And I could feel my neck and my shoulder getting beat up. So I decided I was going to get out of the sled. But to get out of a bobsled in a crash, you kind of want to wait until you're in a curve so there's something to push against. So there's G-forces, so you can kind of push against the sled in the G-forces, which is the gravitational, which is gravity pulling you down. And we're up in the corner, and I kick myself out, and then I kind of put my hands in my helmet and went into a field position, so kind of like curl up into a ball and spun around for about 100 yards. And we kind of stopped, and I was okay, and kind of made sure everything was all right. And I looked across the way, and the sled goes all the way to the bottom of the track because it's going so fast and it's so heavy. It weighs about 1,400 pounds with all the guys in it. And the sled gets to the bottom, and I remember looking down and looking across the track, and it was about a football field away from me. And I saw the guys kind of climbing out, and I saw Todd take off his helmet, and he had just cut his head a little bit. During the crash, and he had some blood running down, and I remember thinking, and I walked down there to the guys, and everybody was okay, and I just remember thinking, wow, that was really, really not fun, and I really hope I don't do it again.
I really hope I don't do it again.
That's a very, very descriptive concept of what going crashing the bobsled.
Who thought that was a cool story? Who thought that was cool? They're going to remember that.
That was epic.
Okay, short question though. Does he have a steering wheel? When you say he's the driver, what's inside there?
So the driver has these two little D-rings, two little pieces of metal that he holds on to, and attached to the metal are these ropes, and the ropes go down to the axle, which is, think about like your parents' car. And you know how the front wheels turn and the back wheels stay straight?
Yeah.
You know how that works in a car? Like, next time you're in a car, next time you're outside of the car, notice that the front wheels turn side to side to drive it, and the back wheels stay straight. Now, the bobsled works the same way, so the driver will pull the rope this way, and the runners will turn this way. And
really?
Pull that way, and the runners will turn that way, and that's how he drives the sled.
Goodness, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Really,
okay. Well, that was worth it. Who came up with that question, Carter? When we brainstorm the questions, and then whoever thinks of it gets to ask it. Brennan. Okay. All right, Brian, you want to say something? Oh, Madison has one more question, and then we have something to say at the end. Okay.
What is your advice to us?
What is my advice to you? In any specific way or just overall?
I don't know if you had a chance to give 10-year-olds advice. You can make separate advice
I would, first of all, I would say, and I already said it earlier, and that's just remember that you're going to be friends with your brother and sister when you grow up, so don't do anything too bad to them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That would be my first thing. And my second thing, I think, would be that make as many friends as possible. I mean, it's Friends Month. And I'm not just saying that because it's Friends Month, but it works really well. I think because friends can help you do everything, and you can help them do everything. Friends, if you have problems, I can say work hard at school, but you know what? If you have good friends, you can all help each other work hard at school. I would say, you know, try hard in sports, but you know what? If you have friends, you'll try hard for each other in sports. You'll be on a team together, and you'll work hard for each other. So I think that would be the most important thing is that make friends and don't judge people that don't judge other kids that you think might be different, that might be different than you. That would be my.
I don't know if you're a reader, but if you read that, it's a kid's book, Wonder. You have to read it. It's so funny what you say and what we've thought for this month in that book. It's well worth, you probably read it in 2 days. It's well worth it if you can do that. It was
awesome.
How many people think you should read that book? He would love it. Okay. Brian, read your little part, and then we have two little gals here are going to read something.
So we are so thankful.
Sorry, start over.
We are so thankful to be included in this program. Thanks for all of your work to make it run. We have some folks that would like to read how being in this program has changed them.
Okay. Who wants to go first?
Thank you.
We are coming to Kaylee.
Okay, Kaylee. Can you see her face? Can you see Kaylee? Okay, here we go. All right.
Classroom Champions has changed me and made me think differently by helping me set my goals. So far, I have not achieved my goals. If I keep working on my goal and trying hard, I may be able to achieve my goal.
That's awesome.
Okay, tell them your name.
Hi, I'm Sierra.
Hi, Sierra.
Classroom Champions changed me by teaching me how to set a goal and to take care of myself. I also learned how to be a better friend and to see what inspires me.
That's awesome.
Good job. Can you hold that over there for Jaden? Can you see Jaden?
I can't see James.
Jaden, scoot over towards Sierra. Be a friend. Let's go. Scoot in. There we go. Now can you? Almost.
Yep.
Lean a little more. You're good. There you go.
Hi, I'm Jaden.
Hi, Jaden.
I love Classroom Champions, and it has changed my lifestyle to setting goals and to be a better person. So go Classroom Champions.
And then we were going to end it with our standing ovation that we've already done for you. Because we already did it for him, Emily. But we did it. We just wanted to thank you. This comes up all the time. They enjoy it. We are taping this, so we'll put it on our YouTube channel. All the stuff that we've done, we've had a ball.
Awesome. Well, I can't thank you guys enough, and I think it is, again, I hope that you think it's cool, because when Lee and I, when we talk about anything that we do, like I said already, when we talk about anything we do, we say, would we think it was cool when we were 10? So as long as you guys think it's cool, then we're going to keep going.
Who thinks it's cool?
It's amazing.
Excellent. We all do. We love it. So thank you for your time and for calling in, and we'll see you on the WebEx. I will.
All right.
Tomorrow.
Sounds good.
All right.
Bye,
everyone. Bye.